Good evening, everyone.
Good evening.
So I see we are, if we look to the schedule, I have to talk to me from 7:20 to 7:40. I just have 20 minutes. How should we do this? Brother Fred will be next. We can just move it a little bit. Okay, then I will just speak. I will be speaking 20 minutes. Okay, very good. Should we have a word of prayer before we start?
Amen.
Our Heavenly Father, we thank Thee tonight for all the blessings that we received during the day. And we thank You, Lord, for the privilege to be here and to share Your word with the brothers and sisters. We pray, Lord, that You will bless this camp meeting in a special way, that You can pour Your Holy Spirit upon us so that we can be prepared for what is coming. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
So I brought a greetings from Curaçao, from my family, and the church down in Curaçao, and also from Brazil. The brothers and sisters in the Caribbean, they send greetings for all our brothers and sisters here in U.S. I'm very glad to be here tonight, and tonight we're going to talk a little bit about health. I have a question. Preparing for the end. Is it important to have good health for what is coming?
Yes.
How many of us remember the Ten Commandments? Probably everyone. How many of us remember the Ten Principles of Health? There are eight? Eight. Okay. I thought there were ten.
Some say 10, but...
Oh, there are eight. Okay, very good. It is Wimar that bring up the New Start. You know, we know New Start Nutrition, and they make some very good studies on that. But back in 1991, I studied preventive healthcare in California, in Dr. Charles Thomas Place, and in combination with Loma Linda University. And that time we had a very, very good program going on in California and also in Loma Linda. I remember Professor Roberts, who always tell us study, and especially anatomy and physiology. Okay, histology, anatomy and physiology. That is very important. And so it also says, in every education system, anatomy and physiology is very important. So, we all are familiar with New Start, eight principles. You remember what is the first one?
Nutrition.
Exercise.
Water.
Sun.
Rest.
Trusting God. Okay, very good. Well, I told you in the beginning, there are 10. But I'm going to share with you two more that is very important. Maybe we don't put too much attention on that, but they are very, very important. The first one that I'm going to share with you is correct posture.
Uh-oh. Don't cross your legs.
Oh, yeah. So, most of the time we are involved in too much in theory, and we don't put the things in practice. And it is when we put things in practice that they start work. Put our theory in practice. You know how to process information, you know, the anatomy and physiology of the brain, processing information. So it is important correct posture. How we? First, stand. How we walk? Is that correct posture?
No.
Why it is important to have correct posture? What is the anatomy and physiology of correct posture?
Breathing would be one of the primary things. Proper breathing.
Exactly. Proper breathing. When we stand straight, when we walk straight, we breathe. But if we don't have correct posture, the first problem that we will have, it is breathing. And do you know what is the first fuel for the body?
Oxygen.
We can live how many days without water? How many days without eating? But 5 or 10 minutes without breathing? You are gone. Yes, very important. Then we have to be sure that we stand in the proper way, that we sit. And what about sleeping? How do we sleep? We have to ask a person how, when they go to sleep, how they sleep. What posture they have on the bed. Some sleep like this the whole night. Some sleep like this, and some sleep this. What is the correct posture of sleeping? You know, if you go to a funeral, that's the best way to learn how people have to rest. Is that true? Always, when people are resting, sleeping, you know, rest. And many people use a lot of
pillows.
Yeah. We have to try to sleep flat. And sometimes in the beginning it's not easy, but practicing, we will be improving and we can sleep better. Yeah, some people, if they don't have 2 or 3 persons, they cannot sleep. But it is not the correct posture in sleeping. That's important. And another one, this is one, the other principle is proper dress. Proper dress.
Mm-hmm.
Proper dress. Mm-hmm. This is very important. Sister White says that shorts, it is Satan who invented short. You know, short pants, everything that is short, everything that, you know, don't cover our body properly. Yeah. And also, you know, clothes that are too tight. Yeah. Today, people are just using a lot of clothes are too tight. And all these things affect our health. We have to have clothes that we can walk, you know, in a way that all the organs can move, you know, smoothly. And also when we breathe, you know, the lungs can have to expand and our blood vessels also have to expand so that we can have good circulation. Don't forget this. Perfect health depend on perfect circulation. And therefore, it is important to have good nutrition. Be sure that all the vitamins, minerals, protein are there to nourish the blood. But then we have to exercise to keep the blood circulating. And this is the foundation for health. We cannot pass away those principles and go and just work on these effects. We have to correct the lifestyle. Very important. The new start is the lifestyle. We have to bring our lifestyle in harmony with the laws of health. And this is very important for the preparation for the days that are ahead. So how are we gonna prepare for the end with our health is to put these principles in practice. Every day some exercise, and it is very good to have every day aerobic exercise where we have we exercise our muscles. It's very important. Muscle exertion in the fresh air. How many remember how many muscles we have? And how many, oh, we can guess how many muscles there is in the body?
636.
And most of the time we don't use, yeah. Yeah, sure. We have to remember that we eat our food, we nourish the body, but we have to remember that strength comes by exercise, and try to exercise the most muscles of your body. And where we have the bigger muscles of the body, the yeah, we have to train ourselves to do some exercise every day. Should we do some exercise like this? Because it is cold, then we will move and have some more circulation. Can we stand up and do some? Just. And breathe, and try to breathe. Breathe. So. Try to deep breathing. When we exercise, deep breathing to get more oxygen to the blood. This is very important. The blood have to be circulating and it have to be good oxygenated. This is very important to have good health. And when we do this, studies have shown that when we exercise, we can concentrate for 45 minutes and not fall asleep. So it is important that we practice exercise how many days a month? Or a week? No, every day. Every day. Every day. And this is will prepare us and help us to have a strong body and a strong mind. And so we will be better to face problems, we will be better, to think properly. And then we will move in the study that we're going to have during these sections. I'm going to talk about IQ and emotional intelligence. How many of us have been heard about IQ? IQ. They say if you have a high IQ, you can go to the best university, Harvard University maybe. Those who are IQ is low and not reach too much. Pardon?
You can go to God's university. And he'll increase your IQ.
But what is the difference between IQ and emotional intelligence? There is a big difference, and we're going to talk about these things during this night, and then we get some more information and also some scientific studies that help us to enhance our emotional intelligence. And we're going to enter a little bit in the study of emotional intelligence. And when you study anatomy, physiology, and also histology, studies have been shown how thinking change brain chemistry. How thinking can change brain chemistry. The question is, what is emotional intelligence? It is the capacity to control one's thoughts and emotion by true and accurate thoughts.
By what? True and accurate.
Uh-huh. By true and accurate thoughts. Okay? Emotional intelligence contributes to successful and enjoyable living than IQ. And we're gonna study this. Since emotional intelligence is learned rather than inherited, it can be improved. We're gonna see some components of the emotional intelligence. Knowing our emotions, being able to identify what you are feeling accurately, managing our emotions, very important, whatever that emotion, or at a given time, that emotion will manage or control them throughout the entire day. People with low emotional intelligence are managed by their emotions. We have to be managed by our emotions? Yes, sure. We have to manage our emotions. People with high emotional intelligence still have emotions, but they are managing their emotions. They are controlling their emotions and not the other way around. Recognizing emotions in others. Identify the feeling of the person you are talking with. Managing relationship with others. Motivating ourselves to achieve our goal. This is very important. It says that emotional intelligence has been shown to help people think clear. Clear thinking. Communicate more effectively. Foster unity in group setting. Reduce polarizing statements. Help you live a more successful and happier life. And all of this is actually accomplished without compromising or sacrificing the truth. There are a lot of people who think that the only way that you can have unity is to compromise truth. And so you get to the lowest common denominator. But what studies clearly show is that unity is a very superficial unity, that when stress comes into the situation, this unity will just be the result. Can we have unity where there is no truth?
No.
If you want to have unity that can withstand stressor, significant stressor, that unity has to be based on truth. John 17, verse 21. It is the only way that unity can work. It has to be based on truth. And truth is a very important component in regard to emotional intelligence. It turns out the factor related in a very linear way to emotional intelligence is teaching yourself to think truthful, non-polarizing, and distorting thoughts. Can you see how important it is to emotional intelligence? our emotions are largely controlled by one, our beliefs. Two, our evaluation of events, the way we think about problems, and our silent self-talk. This is our moment-by-moment thought, the message that we are giving ourselves. That is the major influence on emotional intelligence. And we're going to see an example in the Bible. In the book of Acts 16:16, we see the experience of Paul and Silas in the prison. It says that your feelings result from the message you give yourself. Your thoughts have much more to do with how you feel than what is actually happening in your life. Example of Paul and Silas. Even though they were beaten and chained, they remain what? Cheerful. Can we remain cheerful on the circumstances when they put us in the prison and beat us? Are we prepared emotional for those things that are coming? Big changes is going to take place. You see, the little horn going to change a lot of things. Then emotions will be shaking. People need an experience with Jesus and a true experience. And that just have to be based on what is truth. And here we see the example of Paul and Silas. Even though they were beaten and chained by, they remain cheerful and singing praise to God despite the fact that they were under most difficult and painful conditions. Why is it that the case? What is the case? Because their thought had much more to do with how they were feeling than what was actually happening in their lives. That is how potent the thought can be. They were not thinking pop psychology. Imagining you are on the beach in Hawaii, it would have less than 1 or 2 seconds or minutes. And the reality would have crept in. They were thinking true and accurate thoughts, but those true and accurate thoughts were so powerful that even under that type of situation, they had control over their emotions. And that is what we need today. This is the preparation that God wants to give us. Prepare for the end. We have to be sure that we're not going to be controlled by our emotions, but by the sure word of God, truth, that is Jesus Christ. Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. And so, our emotions have to be controlled by truth, and truth is Jesus Christ. When we have Jesus in our heart, we have the truth, we have the way, we can control our emotions, and we will not be controlled by our emotions. And this is very important for each one of us. There is a study that have been done on cognitive behavior therapy. That is a therapy that they help people that have depression. Because if you cannot control your emotion, then it is easy to fall into depression. And we're going to talk more on this tomorrow night. May God bless us and pray that God will prepare us for the end and that we can have good health. And don't forget the 10 principles. Amen. You have to practice them every day. May God bless us as we study His word. Shall we kneel for a word of prayer? Our Heavenly Father, we thank Thee tonight for the instructions that you give us. Thank you for anatomy, physiology, and thank you, Lord, for the health message that is the right hand of the three angel messages, that we can put all these principles in practice, Lord, so that we can be prepared for the end. Bless each one of us as we put these practicing, these 10 principles of health, that you will bless us with good health, with a strong body, and also with a strong mind to go through what is coming on earth. This is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Es español. That's Spanish. Bonochi. That is my language. Propiamente, bonochi. Good evening. And goedenavond. That is Dutch. And gute nacht. That is German.
Guten Abend.
Guten Abend. As you can say, Guten Abend.
You have all those languages on your island, don't you?
Probably, yeah, because we are an island, a lot of tourists coming from United States, from Europe, from South America and Asia. So good evening to everyone.
Good evening.
So, I'm very glad that we are here to continue with our study that we did yesterday night. So tonight we will just continue on what we started yesterday.
I'm sorry, what's the name of your island?
Curacao.
Curacao,
yes, Curacao. So, okay, shall we kneel down for a word of prayer? Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for all the blessings that we receive during the day, and we thank you for all the messages that we receive, and thank you, Father, that you are so good to us, and every day you are just giving us more instruction, more preparation, so that we can prepare for the end. Bless us, and Lord, let your Holy Spirit will work and help each one of us to understand and to prepare ourselves for the end. This is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. So, for those who are here for the first time, we start our study on health yesterday night. We talked about the 10 principles of health, and we talked also about the emotional intelligence. Most of us people today have know what is IQ, and yesterday we start study emotional intelligence. And emotional intelligence is the capacity to control one's thoughts and emotion by true and accurate thoughts. And tonight we will continue, and this information are very important. I and my wife have been studying this to help our brothers and sisters in the church and people who are also outside the church, communities, we visit schools, and also we visit some congregation who are not Seventh-day Adventists, and we share these things with the people to help them to have correct thought, accurate. So, and tonight we're going to study something very important. That is the CBT, that is Cognitive Behavior Therapy. Before we enter into Cognitive Behavior Therapy, we will study also ACT, therapy. And we will look what is the difference between those two. You know, we have been working in South America, in Brazil, Uruguay, Chile, Venezuela, Colombia. And we noticed that in the Seventh-day Adventist Church, there is a lot of members who are under treatment by psychologists and psychiatrists and using medications.
Psychiatric medications.
And treatments. And once or twice a month, they have to go and visit those person to get help. And for me, this was really painful to see how members of the church have to go to psychologists who didn't believe in God and didn't know about the Bible, and to receive instruction from those persons. It is really painful to see this happen. And we notice also that there is a lot of members who are under depression, are suffering of depression. Studies show today that 3 of patients who visit their doctors today, 1 are depressed, under depression. And that is serious. And the CBT therapy help people who have depression, but also help the emotional intelligence. So, in EC therapy, you have A, and you have C. This is activating events, And the C is consequences, okay? So, this is called the traditional psychotherapy. And traditional psychotherapy teaches you that the reason why you are who you are is simply due to the previous event in your life. And so there is a great analysis of what happened to you earlier on in life and what happened to you later, and reasoning of a lot of those events, and even you trying to remember events that maybe you have not remembered. To try to figure out why you have consequences that you do. And Dr. Ellis, one of the pioneers in CBT, says this is wrong. He has a term for it, crooked thinking. Do you understand this? Crooked thinking. So, crooked thinking. AC thinking is crooked thinking. AC thinking, believing that we have little or no ability to influence our feelings, and that even that event and situation directly cause our emotion and behavior. This is crooked thinking. Now, there is a term that is used repeatedly in scriptures that means bent or crooked. Anyone knows what that term is. That is iniquity. The root word means bent or crooked. The psalmist says, if I regard iniquity in my heart, what is going to be the consequences? The Lord will not hear me. That is Psalm 66, verse 18. It is not because the Lord does not want to hear you, but what does the Bible teach about the Lord? I am the way, the truth, and the life. God is called the God of truth. The Holy Spirit of God is called the Spirit of truth. In fact, there is something that the Bible says that God cannot do. And what is that? God cannot lie. Titus 1:2. He is a free moral agent, I suppose. He could, if he want to, but there is something he put above himself, and that is truth. Psalm 145, verse 18. So now we're going to enter into CBT, that is connective behavior thinking. And this is very important. And we will see how this will help people to have unity. Because in here, we're going to see something very important. We're going to see activating event, that is A, activating event. And then the consequences. And here we will find in the middle B that have to do with belief. This is connective behavior therapy, the EBC thinking. So here we see, still we have activating events. That's true? Activating event. And we will have consequences. Okay. So you still have the activating event. It is there. Can we change it? Can we change things that happen? Can we change the history? And we look at those two. But what we emphasize, there is not a lot that we can do about the past days in our life. The past event, you cannot change. Okay. Thank you so much. But there is something that we can do about the present beliefs, okay? And this is very important if we want to have unity. In groups, unity, in the church, this is very important. It has nothing to do with hypnosis. It has nothing to do with mind control. It is simple. To understand that activating events, our belief will affect the consequences. And we're going to enter more into this and get some examples so that we can understand this. This is very important. But there is something that we can do about the present beliefs, the present beliefs. You can do something about your belief by analyzing them and see if they are true or false and correcting them. And then we can change the present sees consequences. We're gonna see something more. So, connective behavior therapy spend a lot of time in regard to the analysis of belief, and this improve the emotional intelligence. This is an exercise so that you can see if you can figure out when people say what they do, whether they are thinking AC thoughts or whether they are thinking ABC thoughts. And this will help us a lot. Activating events, our belief, and consequences. We're gonna use one example, and during this year, I use a lot of examples going back in the life of Sister White. And one of these events that I was studying on, that's the event when Sister White received his first vision. And there was two men also that God has called to give them this text and to use them as messengers. Do you remember who they were? William Foy and Jason Fox. My question is, why do we think they don't accept? To be a messenger of God. Why do we believe? Activating events, beliefs, and consequences.
Consequences.
And what was the consequences that, for example, William Foy and Hazen Fox said they will not take this? Pride.
He didn't want to criticize for what he was presenting.
Exactly. Exactly.
Reputation. Yeah.
Sure. And then he was afraid of the consequences. And when we are trying to help people to receive Jesus Christ, we have activating events, we have beliefs, and then consequences. When people start changing, correcting their belief, what will happen in their life? What consequences will come?
Do I lose your job?
For example, I was not keeping the Sabbath, but I was a Christian. I was reading my Bible. I was going to the church on Sunday. And then I come to study, and Shalom teach me about the Sabbath. Now my belief have to
change.
To change. I have to correct my belief, because I believe that Sunday was the day to worship. But now I study the Bible, and then I see that the Bible says it is not Sunday, but it is Sabbath. And then my belief, I have to correct. And then I will have the consequences. Because my job, maybe I have to work on Sabbath. But we know that the Bible says we can do all things in through Christ who strengthens us. And today still, many of us is in the valley of decision because of our beliefs. If we have to correct our belief in on certain things, we will see that we will have consequences. So, people who are depressed, they need this therapy. They need have a strong faith to take some decision because of their new belief, or correcting their belief, they will have consequences. And this will be, as we come closer to the end, we will have more and more and more problems that we have to have more faith to correct our beliefs because it have consequences. Even though we are strong Christians, even though we have a very good experience in our spiritual life, do you remember Elijah? After he was on Mount Carmel with the prophets, what happened when Jezebel says, and Elijah was depressed after that? Yeah, he fell in depression. And you know, people who fall in depression most of the time try to be in caves, try to hide themselves, or enter in their room and put all curtains. They don't want nobody to see them or to be in contact with nobody because they are depressed. And it is in connective behavior therapy, they help people who are depressed to come out, and they have to change their belief. I just want to have some feedback on this, because this is very important to understand connective behavior therapy and how we can use all these informations that we have today to help our people to come out from depression and also to have unity. This is very important. We cannot have unity if we don't correct our belief and not to have crooked thinking or polarizing, using polarizing statements. And then God will help us to have unity, John 17, 21 to 23.
I didn't realize until recently that Elijah won a great victory on Mount Carmel.
Mm-hmm.
And when he ran, he had depression. The angel said, "What are you doing here?" But God wanted to work even a greater miracle if he stood up to Jezebel. I did not realize that.
Amen. Amen.
And he would not have been depressed.
Mm-hmm. That's right. That's right. Sure. So we see how important it is to really understand the anatomy and physiology also of the brain, how it works, and how we can help people. Therefore, the spirit of prophecy says that doctors can do a work 10 times bigger than a pastor can do, because they can help the people with many instructions. Because today, on the subject of justification by faith, different subject, Godhead, there is many, many, many brothers and sisters that we met in Brazil, in Uruguay. They come out of the church, but still they have to correct their belief. And these problems, is the major problem that we don't see the unity today. Is there some question? Is it clear? We understand this? How it works? Because of time, we cannot go into all these definitions, all those things like jumping to conclusion, fortune teller error. We cannot enter into a magnifying or minimizations. All these things have to do with the EBC thinking, that is connective behavior therapy.
What did the A stand for?
The A? The A stand for activating events.
Thank you.
Yes, things that happen are in our life, in the past, or things that happen that we cannot change. But even though if we change our belief, we will also activate our events. So we see something very important. Magnifying self also bring problem. And therefore, when Nebuchadnezzar just magnify himself in Babylon, then God has to humble him. And he need this therapy also. Therefore, God have to put him on a plant-based vegetarian diet, exercise, sleep, wake cycle, light and darkness cycle, hydrotherapy, and connective behavior therapy. And then he could come back. And then we have to correct our beliefs. And this will help us to have unity among brothers and sisters in the church, wherever we are, in schools, in community, because these simple principles help us to have accurate and correct thoughts. May God bless us as we study and to prepare for the end. Amen. Shall we kneel down for a word? As if there is no question, we will kneel down for a prayer. Okay? Okay, no question, we will kneel down. Our Heavenly Father, we thank Thee for all the blessings that we receive from Your Word, and we thank You, Father, also for the way that You have been blessed us, Lord, with the knowledge of anatomy and physiology, especially of the brain, that we can understand how thoughts can change brain chemistry. But we pray, Lord, that You will give us a strong faith and that we can every day pray and meditate and also study Your Word to correct our beliefs so that, Lord, we can also see the consequences. And pray that You will strengthen us and have a faith, Lord, to stand for truth because it is truth. And that, Father, that Your peace and Your Holy Spirit can help us every day to come closer. And as we come closer to the end, Father, that big decisions have to be made in our life, that we don't see the consequences, but that we can put our faith and our trust in Jesus Christ, and so that we can stand firm for the Lord and see Jesus Christ coming. This is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Good evening, everyone.
Amen.
So we are glad that we are here again to continue with our study tonight. Tonight we're going to study, we're going to finish our study on how to enhance our emotional intelligence. And tonight I'm going to talk, and especially for the little ones, our little ones, it is very important how to improve intelligence in children and adults. So in Jonathan and in Zachariah, and some other little ones in the back that I don't know their name, but it is important for them also. And I want you to put good attention tonight, because we're going to touch some topic very important that youth are involved today, and it could be dangerous for the brain. And so God will help us to understand these points that so can we can improve in our intelligence. So we will kneel down for a word of prayer before we start. Our Heavenly Father, once more we want to give thanks for all the blessings that we receive during the day. And as we enter into the study, we pray that Your Holy Spirit will help each one of us to understand and to put in practice all that we have been learning during this camp meeting. Let Your peace rest upon us as we study Your Word. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. So we will go quickly on some points that is important for us to know how to improve intelligence in children and adults. First, it says, avoid toxins. Toxins to the brain will adversely affect the IQ. Alcohol affects first the frontal lobe. As we study anatomy and physiology, we see the frontal part of the brain. This is a frontal lobe of the brain before affecting other portion of the brain. This is the area of spirituality, morality, and the will. Yeah. It is the area where we make our decisions. Is the judgment area of the brain, the analytic portion of the brain. Once alcohol is taken, it takes 2 weeks for critical abstract thinking to come back. How many weeks?
Two weeks.
Can you imagine that? 2 weeks. Your coordination may be okay, but you lack judgment because the frontal lobe is adversely affected by the alcohol. That's why so many accidents due to the poor judgment, not coordination. It says nicotine suppress effect on frontal lobe. Leads also in toys. So we have to be careful with our children because in these toys there's a lot of leads and these also affect the brain. Caffeine actually affect the adenosine receptors in the frontal lobe of the brain. Blocks the adenosine receptors. It also has too much of another chemical, acetylcholine, available. Actually, what it does is to destroy the enzymes called acetylcholine stressor, which makes too much acetylcholine available. And this is why people under the influence of caffeine feel stimulated. And do you know there's a lot, I have met a lot of Seventh-day Adventists who cannot function if they don't take a cup of coffee in the morning. They have to take some coffee to stop this functioning of the body. And it says that typists type faster under the influence of caffeine, but make 10 times more errors. Also, another study show relationship of caffeine and gossip. Gossip defined as sharing private information with someone who is not part of the problem or part of the solution to the problem. If you have caffeine aboard, you are significantly more likely to do that than when you don't have caffeine on board. That's simply due to that loss of break in the frontal lobe of the brain that comes from blocking those adenosine receptors. You see, when people take a cup of coffee, all the things that are this caffeine is doing with the brain, and especially the frontal lobe. Healthy lungs, healthy brain. Deep breathing. For children, healthy lungs may mean healthier scores of tests of memory, learning, and intelligence. Therefore, Sister White says, children from 0 to 7, 6 or 7 have to be in the garden, just running, you know, as animals, yes, as lambs. Because the important thing in children is their lungs. They have to develop their lungs. But today, you know, we see they put children from 2, 3 years, they put them in classroom. and we see the result of all the big problems that we have with children today in school, young children. It says, for children, healthy lungs may mean healthier scores of tests of memory, learning, and intelligence. Researchers at Harvard University examined data on 175 Boston children who had been followed since birth. At age 6, the children had their lung function tested. At age 9, they completed standard tests of memory, learning, ability, and intelligence. The researchers found that for each increase in the children's lung function performance, there was a corresponding increase in their cognitive test scores, also tests in adults. Results are related to a deep breathing, and therefore we need to practice deep breathing. Practice deep breathing. It is very, very important for good health. Now, Sister White was 100 years ahead of medical science. And today, science come to these investigations, and what Sister White says, 100 years ahead, is true. And she says in Child Guidance, page 364 to 375, he says, the one who sit and stand erect is more likely than other to breathe properly. Do you remember the 10 principles? One of these 10 principles that was correct posture. But the teachers should impress upon the pupils the importance of deep breathing. Show how the healthy action of the respiratory organs assisting the circulation of the blood invigorates the whole system, exciting the appetite, promotes digestion, and induce sound, sweet sleep. Thus, not only refreshing the body, but soothing and tranquilizing the mind. And while the importance of deep breathing is shown, the practice should be insisted upon. Let exercise be given which will promote this, and see that the habit becomes established. Child Guidance 364 and 365. So one more quotation, how Sister White says in manuscript release, volume 7, page 334. She says, sleep is worth far more before than midnight. 2 hours good sleep before 12 o'clock is worth more than 4 hours after 12 o'clock. Is there science in here? So, let me read now what science says about sleeping. A lifestyle habit of sleeping. Lifestyle habit related to melatonin. Melatonin caused about as a result of darkness and being in dark environment. When darkness falls, it will start to spike and it will reach its peak at 2 a.m. and shut down again when lights come in the morning. So, Sister White says, 2 hours before 12 o'clock is more worth than 4 hours after 12 o'clock. So, it says here, melatonin is related to your ability to retain the information you have learned that day. Melatonin production between 9 to 2 at 2 p.m. is reaches its peak. If you go to bed 2 hours after 9 p.m. or midnight, you will decrease the area under that curve by 50%. You will have less melatonin output as a result of being a late nighter. Early to bed, early to rise, make a person healthy, wealthy, and wise. Is that important for our little children?
Yes.
Yeah? This is very important. So I'm going to share one more quotation. Ministry of Healing, page 296. It says, they impart strength, power, endurance, and a vigor of intellect that are not afforded by a more complex and stimulating diet. And here it says, high carbohydrates, low fat diet. It says, it improves weight loss, high carbohydrate diet. It enhances mood, speed thinking, while both a high and a low carbohydrate diet seems to boost the speed of connective processing. The interest result was that comparing to the high carbohydrate diet, subject consuming the low carbohydrate diet had a smaller improvement. Here we see that fruits, vegetables, nuts, and grains are the best fruits, are the best food for us as human beings. What the frontal lobe desire is a diet higher in carbohydrates. Carbohydrates are used almost exclusively by the brain for optimal function. Spirit of Prophecy, Council on Diet and Food, page 360. And studies show that arachidonic acid decreases ability. It decreases the synthesis and storage of acetylcholine, and an important neurotransmitter in the frontal lobe of the brain. Primary present in flesh food. And Sister White says, Council on Diet and Food, meat and intelligence. Eating much flesh will diminish intellectual activity. Students would accomplish much more in their studies if they never tasted meat. When the animal part of the human nature is strengthened by meat eating, the intellectual powers diminish a great deal. And we see how important it is that we follow these principles of health that God has given us through the Spirit of Prophecy. Ministry of Healing, page 303, says, especially harmful are the custard and puddings in which milk, eggs, and sugar are the chief ingredients. The free use of milk and sugar together should be avoided. So, scientific studies show food containing harmful cholesterol byproducts. Study by Bruce Taylor. Feeding monkeys with oxidized cholesterol oxidized cholesterol is the most damaging, and damage will occur within 24 hours. Cluster is a source of the most harmful cholesterol to monkey aortas and brain blood cells are cluster mixed milk, sugar, and egg. When you mix up cholesterol, the eggs, in a sugar environment, you will oxidize that cholesterol and cause significant damage. It does not take long, within 24 hours. For example, ice cream, pancake mix, powder the eggs, thus oxidized cholesterol. And it says lard and cheese. Now I'm gonna skip some part and I go directly now to a very important part, especially for children today. It has to do with a problem of hypnosis. It says hypnosis attempt to cancel out frontal lobe function and bring people into a trance in which they are highly suggestible. This is most easily accomplished by training the eyes to focus in on one object, the best object being a little flickering light. A little flickering light. The person will record information and duties without interpretation or without frontal lobe activity. Hypnotic instrument in homes that trains the eye to focus in on one object and flicker is the TV. And today we have this big problem because most of our little ones like to watch TV all the time. And today, not only they have TV at home, but they have their electronic devices that they can carry with them everywhere. And some studies have been shown how these things has caused damage to the brain of our little ones. And we have to be careful how we handle with our little ones. Don't let them be all the time on those electronic devices. Let them do many work. Let them be more practical in a 3D situation so that they can develop all it says constant stimulation of the senses. Constant stimulation of the senses shut down the analytic process and ultimately shut down the ability to face life rationally. This is what TV and all these electronic devices do to the brain. So, I'm gonna cut down here because of time. We come to the conclusion. Do you want to be more intelligent? Be more analytical? Make better decisions? Have a greater capacity to empathize with others? Have better discernment? Have greater ability to see into the future, to reason from cause to effect? Have greater ability to overcome an addiction? Have greater power to follow your conscience? Be more open to understand and doing the will of God? If the answer is yes, I encourage you to review your life habits and what you do on a daily basis and see what you can do to change your lifestyle and to optimize your brain function, particularly the frontal lobe of the brain. Your life is in front of you, and your success and happiness in this life is directly dependent upon your ability to make those positive changes that can also help the Holy Spirit of God influence you to a greater degree. And I'm going to show a quotation to finish of Sister White. Education page 124. As a mean of intellectual training, the Bible is more effective than any other book. Or all other books combined. The greatness of its themes, the simplicity of its utterance, the beauty of its images quicken and uplift the thought, and nothing else can. No other study can impart such mental power as do the effort to grasp the stupendous truth of revelation. The mind thus brought in contact with the thoughts of the infinite cannot but expand and strengthen. Education, page 124. I'm going to finish now with another quotation of Sister White. It says, before we go, it is Christ Object Lesson, page 334. Be determined to become useful and efficient as God calls you to be. Be thorough and faithful in whatever you undertake. Procure every advantage within your reach for strengthening the intellect. And mind, character, and personality, she says, continual development. The Lord has given man capacity for continual improvement and has granted him all possible aid in the work. Through the provision of divine grace, we may attain almost to the excellence of the angels. Can we imagine that? So, the challenge is that we have to pray to God and put in practice all the principles that He gives us, so that we can improve and that we can continually improve, and has granted him all possible aid to work. I mean, God has given us all what we need to do the work. Through the provision of divine grace, we may attain almost the excellence of the angels. May God bless us as we put all these principles, obey all these principles, so that we can be prepared with the intellect, strengthen it, so that we can meet what is coming in these last days, that we can prepare for the end, and we can have strong minds, strong physical body to meet what is coming. May God bless us as we study His Word. Shall we kneel down for a word of prayer? Our Heavenly Father, we thank Thee for Your health message. We thank You, Lord, that You will help each one of us, that we can put in practice all these principles of health, so that by the aid of the Holy Spirit, we can be able to improve every day, so that we can have a strong faith, a strong mind, a strong body, so that we can be prepared for the end. Bless us as we pray in Jesus' name.